Since the day man became conscious, we have questioned our world. Who, what, when, where, how, and of course, why. Over time, our greatest minds have worked tirelessly to satiate our curiosity, answering countless of our questions on the nature of we humans, the natural laws, and the world. But many questions remain unanswered. Chief among them, the most important question we can ask. A question every great mind has tried to answer, and every great mind has failed. That question is as such. What's the deal with YouTuber music? Hey buds, or as they say in Japan, Guten Tag, Kumpel, Aged Naoriate here. If you have browsed YouTube any amount of time, you would have noticed that YouTube is quite a diverse place for content. It's like that one line in Forrest Gump. Life's like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're gonna get. Which, by the way, that phrase makes no sense at all. What do you mean you don't know what you're gonna get? It says so on the back of the box! Anyways, there are countless kinds of videos on this website in many genres, including animation, comedy,
oh my baby, it's gonna be fine,
commentary.
So if you see me stepping on bread and coming in my pants, you know I was taught by the master.
Cooking.
It's just chaos in the kitchen, that's my brand!
The almighty and glorious edutainment.
Moral of the story, kids, don't eat strange bread. You could trip balls and die.
And gaming.
Put him out! Put him out! Put him out! Who are you people? Save Garfield!
But there is one genre, even larger than the rest. Music. Music and YouTube go together like YouTube and music. Ever since the site's founding, people have been posting music and music videos onto it. And whilst at the start, many in the music industry were, skeptical of YouTube, to say the least. Nowadays, they embrace it, with many top-charting artists starting out on YouTube. Hell, even King Crimson has stopped their crusade against people posting their music on YouTube, and finally released it, and even made an official YouTube channel, no less. Ugh, never thought I would see the day. I grew up listening to all my music on YouTube. It's where I have discovered the countless bands and genres I now love, and dare I say, learned a lot about myself along the way. It's to the point where, despite the fact that I am a big old zoomer, I just can't get used to using Spotify and always default to YouTube for my music needs. It truly is the perfect platform for both music and entertainment, with the two sides existing in a sort of symbiotic relationship, where one brings them to the site and the other one traps them there, enthralling them in a certain content creator. Before you know it, they've bought copious amounts of merch, created a Stan Twitter account, and joined the Stan army, harassing anyone who dared to even have the potential of defaming their idol, before becoming disillusioned with it all and being thrown out of the group. Nothing like home. Of course, entertainment and music industries have been intertwined long before YouTube was even born, which was a C-section, by the way. C-section.
I didn't ask for this.
Big entertainment stars would do music, and big musicians would do entertainment. Because the larger and more profitable you are, the more you can expand into foreign markets. Like a local restaurant making enough money to open up another store in a different city. Only it's celebrities going down the street from the Capitol Records building to the Pantages Theater. When a YouTuber gets big enough to justify a diversified portfolio, they can start expanding their content in areas they would not normally tread, such as podcasts, acting, traditional media, and most commonly of all, music. I mean, it makes sense why so many choose to do music. Everyone likes music, so everyone has at least a little bit of interest in creating the stuff. And I think it's great that so many YouTubers choose to explore this interest of theirs, as I think for any interest really. However, because just so many people have this interest and want to create music, statistically, they're not all going to be good. The best example of this being the just sheer amount of YouTuber music that came out in 2017 and 18. If you remember that time as well as I do, I'm sure you can agree with me that a lot of it was, pretty bad.
This is Team 10, bitch, who the hell I'm flipping you?
It was just a flood of the same terribly forced rap music into the YouTube market, leaving the actually good music lost in the depths. It's slowed down nowadays since then. And by slow down, I mean I don't see it on the trending tab every day locking arms with one of the Jimmys and the Try Guys. But that still leaves the question. What's the deal with YouTuber music? And why is so much of it so bad?
There it is!
Weh, I didn't know this was a Family Guy funny moment. Now, YouTuber music can generally be divided into two categories. Musicians who are YouTubers, and YouTubers who also do music. In other words, people who did music before getting big on YouTube, and those that started doing it after they achieved success on YouTube. Those in the musicians who are YouTubers category include YouTubers like Knowledge Hub, Nikki Jakey, Boyna Band, Varg Skelethor, Jared Dines, and Joji. Look, I know Joji doesn't do YouTube anymore, and he's solely a musician now, but he is pretty relevant right now, eh? Ah, Twitter. You terrible website, you. Those in the remaining YouTubers who also do music category include PewDiePie, The Pauls, The Odd Ones Out, Jaden Animations, Moist Critical, and Rice Gum. Now, within these two sections, most of what people think of when they think YouTuber music, particularly the bad kind, is in the YouTubers who also do music category. Now, let me clarify that I am not saying that one side is only good music and the other is only bad. It's never a good idea to deal in absolutes. I enjoy a lot of the music in the YouTubers who also do music category. For example, I quite like the music of the creators who Boyna Band collaborated with. The Odd Ones Out and Jaden Animations' music is quite catchy and successful in what they were trying to do, far better than many of their peers. Although the one that stands out to me is PewDiePie's music. All his songs, be they with Boyna Band or others, are quite exceptional, with catchy tunes, lyrics, and tied together with impeccable visuals in his music videos. The longer you work on a skill, the better you become in it. For example, this is why I tend to like more of the music on the right than on the left. They've just had more time to develop their skills and create better music. Although the only artist in the musicians who do YouTube category that I'm not really that into is Joji, as his music just really isn't my style. I still have huge respect for the man, mind you, but I'm more into stuff like of course, personal preference is a factor as well in what people consider good. But I think the reason why a very large percentage of people consider a lot of YouTuber music bad is, well, one, because of what I said before in that they are beginners to music, so their songs aren't exactly going to be as polished and have the same feeling as those who have experience in the field. But another reason is that a few of these YouTubers who go into music see it as another way to make some cash and not as the, I'm gonna get pretentious here, art and form of expression it is. And like all art, to make it good, you have to put into it more than just canvas and paint. To make soulful and expressive music, one must put their soul in it. To make a song with personality, one must put in some personality into it. To make good music, one must put some good into it. A story, some kind of motif, something. Copying what everyone else is doing is not going to make good music. Flexing wealth is not a personality. And just pumping money into it will not make good music. But that's just me. I'm not a musician, so what do I know, eh? Alright, let's get into my favorite part of the video and go into some more detail on some of these artists, to put some backing into these opinions I just can't stop dropping. First artist I will be talking about is a favorite of mine, Knowledge Hub. Now I know what you might be thinking. Knowledge Hub doesn't do music, but he actually has his Knowledge Hub SoundCloud linked into every video, and it is glorious. The only way I can describe it is that it's like the musical version of whatever the hell it is I make in my spare time, except he actually puts time, effort, and talent into it, a bit like Joji's Pink Guy albums. how he can have such excellent quality in his music makes a lot more sense when you realize that Tyler, the man who runs Knowledge Hub, is actually a musician by trade and has another, more serious SoundCloud music project called No Sustain, which in my opinion has some bangers that even surpasses my favorite Knowledge Hub songs. It's not as high octane and absurd as his Knowledge Hub work, but it is more moderate in tempo and sound, but still retains the creativity he is known for. Can you tell I'm a fan of his music? Now you might be wondering what genre of music Tyler plays, but the answer is more complicated than it seems. All of Tyler's music has commonalities to it, like the prevalence of keyboard synth and distorted vocals, but each and every one of his songs can be put into a different genre that I am just not knowledgeable enough to identify. If you want to know if you want to listen to Tyler and his work, check out his song Civil War 2. It's a very interesting song with elements of rap, electronic, and I even personally get a sense of punk in the chorus. It's great. What Knowledge Hub shows is how some musicians who are YouTubers can make great music relatively under the radar for the typical subscriber, while bad YouTuber music makes sure to let everyone know that they have music and to buy it. The next artists I will be covering are Varg Skelethor Joel and Jared Dines, mainly to satisfy my mandatory heavy metal reference for this video. Now I have watched these two for a long time now. Joel has been a favorite streamer and YouTuber of mine for years, and I have watched many of Jared Dines' videos on metal casually over the years. Jared makes music with his band Rock Daddy, as well as some solo work that gets a surprisingly high amount of views for heavy metal music on YouTube. Although I haven't listened to enough of Jared's music to make an accurate assessment of whether or not I like it, but from what I've listened to, Rock Daddy seems to be a less harsh metal, perfect for those wanting to dip their toes into the genre. Now of these two, it makes sense for Jared to be a musician. I mean, his channel is focused on heavy metal music, but finding out Joel did metal as well was a surprise, but a welcome one. You see, Varg Skelethor Joel is in a band called Scythe Lord, which plays original and unique thrash metal with a vocal style more reminiscent of death metal. And I'm not talking a "ugh," but a more "ah" kind of style, you know? It makes sense. Joel is Swedish, and the Swedes practically breathe death metal. Similar to how the Norwegians emulate black metal and the Finns love them some folk metal. His music is great. If you like some good, more extreme heavy metal, check out Scythe Lord. What Varg Skelethor Joel and Jared Dines show us is how that one can achieve popularity and make good music without having to follow what others are doing, while bad YouTuber music just follows the trends and does not explore any more original kinds of music they might want to make. They just follow where the money is. Now let's touch on the archetypical bad YouTuber music artists, the Pauls. I know, it is so brave of me to criticize the Pauls' music. It's never been done before. I'm practically a trailblazer here, but I have to, because the Paul brothers and their now infamous music embody everything bad with YouTuber music. Obnoxious, constant flexing, advertising merch in the song,
buy that merch,
lyrics with the depth of a puddle, and just not being very good. But being serious here, everyone knows that. Since 2017, everyone has known that. So, I'm not gonna say what has been said 100 times before and just leave it at that. Besides, I'm not smart and analytic enough to actually think of anything new to add. The Paul Brothers' music is like the fire festival of YouTube music. It shows us what not to do. And all things considered, that's pretty important. Knowing what not to aim at is just as crucial as knowing what you want to aim at. Now let's finish with an artist I actually like, that being Moist Critical or Penguins Zero, the man, the myth, the legend. The music Critical puts out is so polished that it is hard to believe he wasn't a musician previously, but what I think Critical does the best in his music is that he makes his music with a clear message and theme that is evident from the title alone. It is because of that theme that people keep coming back. Well, at the catchy tune. Who knew Critical singing would sound so good? What Moist Critical's music shows us is how a theme and purpose for the song's lyrics is important in making the song have some sort of meaning. Bad YouTuber music has no meaning or purpose, just to make money and flex. To summarize this long video and to answer the question asked in the intro, YouTubers go into music when they feel they have a safe enough platform to justify expanding their channel. And the reason many of this music being made is substandard is because many are new to the music industry and are enticed by the money of it. Of course, not all YouTuber music is bad. I mean, I just spent all this time praising a bunch of YouTuber music I think is good. But there is still a sizable portion, both a couple years ago and today, of the kind of music that people think of when they hear bad YouTuber music. What's the deal with YouTuber music and why is so much of it bad? In short, a shallow focus on profits combined with a lack of experience making music. I'm Oldengold, and thanks for watching.